So we're going to start the morning by spotlighting digitalization's effect on our business models. Manufacturers know that the demand can be volatile and difficult to predict, but our capabilities are changing. Companies that have adopted digitalization in key areas like production, supply chain, and product development are capitalizing on their increased demand visibility to be far more agile. In this case study that we're about to have this morning, Raj Batra, president of Siemens Digital Factory, is going to lead a discussion on how to embrace digitalization to help solve the novel engineering challenges of the design, construction, commissioning, and production of a greenfield plant. And his guest panelist will be Nain Rivera, automation manager for Tenaris U.S.A. And so at this time, I'm delighted to invite my good friend Raj Batra up to the podium.
Stephen, thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Great to be here. I think the cover of the slides using digitalization to make manufacturing a competitive weapon is really very, very fitting, because how many of you really feel that manufacturing, if you're running manufacturing operations, it really is a competitive weapon, and it's the best of the best, and you're positioned to net export. And I think when you embrace the people that have embraced digitalization really find that this is one of their biggest differentiators and biggest advantages in industry today. So, and I have to be honest, the topic for me has been a hot button issue for a long time. So for too many years, I would just say we treated manufacturing as a black box, as a process or as an activity that more or less just had to get done. And so without exaggerating too much, the feeling has been it really doesn't matter where it happens, how it happens, as long as the costs go down and the productivity goes up. And I would even argue that some people are celebrating their automation system's 40th anniversary, in their plant. That's really not a good thing, because you don't want to celebrate four decades of having an automation system when you're updating your iPhone every 5 or 6 months. So, and of course, that was never a great strategy. So in the age of, a lot of hyper-connected, vocal consumers who are active on Facebook, active on Twitter, you definitely don't want to be the company that outsourced production to the lowest bidder. And, today consumer preferences are changing. So people want the latest product produced at the highest quality, and in a lot of cases, customized just for them and at a reasonable price. And the last thing is they want it now. They want it today. And there are great examples of what mass customization has done. We heard a lot about digital disruption and what that's driving, but mass customization is playing a very, very critical role in the companies that are going to survive and the ones that won't. And the header here, digitalization changes everything. If you think about the stats, digital disruption is shaving 45% off of incumbent companies' revenue growth. It's shaving 35% off their EBIT. You can't see those stats on there. These are just some other stats. And roughly half the Fortune 500 disappeared since 2000. And the main cited reason was digitalization. So now if you look at these stats and you look at some of the major trends here, obviously by 2020, a quarter of the world's economy is going to be digital. We're going to have a trillion connected devices. And if you think about devices connected in the manufacturing environment, the simplest control sensor and actuator on the factory floor can emit data, can do it wirelessly, can move it anywhere in the plant infrastructure, can move it anywhere on Wi-Fi, can move it on your iPad if you're sitting in Starbucks. So everything is connected. And the question is, how much of that data are people using? And there's also another fact that says, roughly half the world's data was generated in just less than last year, but only a few percentage points of that data are even being used. So we're becoming a very, very connected economy. And also by 2050, there are going to be 10 billion people inhabiting our planet, either interacting directly or indirectly with all these devices that are connected. So these are the big, massive changes, the cataclysmic changes that are affecting all of us. And that change can be very stressful. Now, the guy in that picture is not really stressed out. And of course, if you look at him, I don't know if he's looking at his Twitter account or looking at his stock portfolio, but he certainly looks comfortable. And he's lying on a zero-gravity mattress that was made by Starpool, which is a Siemens customer in Italy. And they plan and install wellness centers around the world, rely on advanced automation, digitalization, simulation. So that star pool bed, that zero gravity bed, was designed and simulated with very advanced technology. And what I want to show there is the scalability of where digitalization applies. It's not just for the big guys. It's not just for the Fortune 500s, you know, at least the half of them that are left. It's for the small and mid-sized enterprises. It's a very, very scalable technology. And so if Starpool can use it in a zero gravity mattress, I mean, it can be applied anywhere. And so, you know, but that guy's not worrying about all that stuff. That stuff is sort of behind the scenes. He's relaxing and having a nice time. And the sensors and all that are really helping enhance that. So let's talk about the journey of digitalization and where it's evolved from. I'm not going to go back much prior to the 90s. So, you know, I guess the common is whether it's spa equipment, whether it's aircraft parts, whether it's seamless steel pipes in the oil and gas industry, which you're going to hear about later today. I mean, this is applicable everywhere. And it's having a big impact on the way people do things, how they do it, how much money they make, how profitable they are. And so if you think about how we've arrived at this point, I mean, the 90s was an era of automating a little bit more. You know, people that didn't use advanced automation in manufacturing facilities, and there's still a lot of people that and I can tell you, even in big, you know, the big iconic Fortune 500, there are places that are still very manual. There's a lot of brute force work that could be automated that's not automated. So the 90s was the theme was really automating a little more, and that was the sort of key theme, and you could get more productivity, increments of productivity. We arrived in the 2000s, and we started taking the first steps in integrating automation and engineering processes, and that made the value chain a bit more flexible, but only slightly, so another increment of productivity. And then we arrive today in a digitalized world. And we talk about a digital twin. And it's important to understand what this digital twin is and why this is so important. It's so important very, very simply because you can do all your work virtually and in a simulated way before you do any physical activity happens on the factory floor. So the example you're going to hear about today, Starpool, Adidas, you know, we have so many iconic names out there, people that have done this. And this is the great decisive competitive weapon of manufacturing as we enter this era of digitalization, a digital twin, a holistic digital twin. So the intensity of our focus on digitalization has never been stronger. And, you know, if you go back to when we started talking about integrating design and automation, right, and we started talking about this, I think back in about 2007, we made the first acquisition. People thought we were crazy. They're like, well, we know Siemens is a great automation company, but why in God's name are you buying all these software companies and talking about design? Because they couldn't have imagined a decade later what the value contribution of software is to the development of product and to the development of manufacturing processes. And you know, these terms have been around for a long time. Design for production, design for manufacturing. We've all heard those. I think they've been around since the 70s. But inherently, the technology was never there to be able to bridge the gap of the design environments and the manufacturing environments. And if you don't control the design adequately, you don't control the manufacturing processes adequately. So, you know, 80% of manufacturing costs are generally predetermined in the product design phase. So the digital twin is the great differentiator for companies that want to simulate the product, the process, the production environment, and do it all on a common digital thread. And so what that did was that let us combine the virtual and the real worlds. So it started with automation. Obviously, in automation, that's the real world. I mean, we have automation on the factory floor, and you need that as a game changer to do things physically, to do things mechanically. But the combination of integrating ideation of product and design environments with automation is really where that digital twin is created. So if you think about our journey in Siemens, we, since 2007, acquired about $10 billion worth of software companies. It started in 2007 with a company called UGS. And they were a world leader in product design, product data management, digital manufacturing. And of course, it was a standalone business. I mean, they weren't tied to a manufacturing company. They weren't tied to an automation company. So they were selling largely into CIO environments. And if you go back historically, CIOs controlled that environment controlled the design of products, and the manufacturing people controlled the manufacturing of products. And that, by the way, still largely exists today. There's that cultural divide still exists. In some cases, it's being broken down. But when you're combining software and design and manufacturing automation is really where the game-changing effect is. And to do a digital twin, you can't do a digital twin if you just have capability to design the product. Because then how do you address the plant floor? How do you address the manufacturing floor? And you can't do a digital twin if you're just an automation player and you're virtualizing and simulating what's happening on the manufacturing floor. So to do it holistically and to do it effectively, you have to have both of these components. You have to have the design environments covered, and you have to have the manufacturing and automation environments covered. And so when we talk about a digital twin, the key is not just mechanical modeling and mechanical simulation. The key is to simulate the physical item and asset and all its mechanical, thermal, fluid dynamic properties, whatever properties that physical asset has. You want to be able to virtualize and simulate that with a very, very high degree of accuracy. Because if you can virtualize and simulate it, you can do all your work and improvement and planning outside of the physical environment. You can perfect it. And this is what companies are doing. They're perfecting the process. They're perfecting how they're designing a product. They're perfecting the ergonomics of a plant floor. They're perfecting how lines are working. If you change dynamics on a product, how does that affect your manufacturing process? So it's all interwoven. But to simulate, you have to be on a digital backbone. That's the key. And so companies that are embracing this are cutting their time to market of products by 50%. They're cutting the engineering time by 30 or 40%. You're going to hear a lot of examples of this. They're taking delivery times that have been 18 months down to a week because they have to mass customize. And I'll give you a few more examples of that. So that's a digital twin. A digital twin is a holistic, completely holistic model of what the physical asset is. And that's where the power is as we step into this new era of Industry 4.0, of next generation manufacturing, and the industrial IoT worlds. So let me just give you a quick video here of a company that lives and dies on this. I mean, and again, it's not a big Fortune 500 company, but what it is, it's a company that needs these cutting edge advantages to compete and to succeed.
There's a digital race that takes place far before we ever get to the racetrack. Engineering's the cornerstone of performance in motorsports.
We've got many engineers from masters in mechanical engineering to aerodynamicists, fluid dynamicists, electrical engineers.
You know, this is it. This is the premier motorsports organization, at least in NASCAR racing.
Our biggest thing here at Hendrick Motorsports is managing change. You know, our business changes so rapidly. We've got to have performance and we've got to have reliability. Having an engine that finishes the race but doesn't perform doesn't do you any good.
In NASCAR, they have what's called an open garage policy.
The garage is a self-policing area, so you park next to your strongest competitor, and you know, you're kind of looking at what they do, and they kind of look at what you do. So the shelf life of a good idea is only a week or two.
To reinvent yourself every week from one race to the next is basically what we have to do.
When you show up at the racetrack, you've basically got the product you're going to have. You're just doing little teeny things to try to get it fine-tuned.
In the front of our transporter at every racetrack, there's five engineers and myself in the front of that transporter just trying to figure out how to build a faster and better mousetrap than the other guys.
Whenever we have an issue at the racetrack, whether it's from a component failure standpoint or maybe from NASCAR coming to us saying that they don't like us doing whatever X component is, we immediately get in touch with the design staff at Hendrick Motorsports. They go through, they make the revisions, they make changes, or they completely start over.
We look at our race schedule, when you boil it down, it's essentially 36 product release dates every year.
If NASCAR changes rules and we can take advantage of that rule faster than our competition, we can win races.
We've got engine dynamometers and a lot of test equipment that can produce a tremendous amount of data. And being able to mine that data to get the value out of it is a key for us.
So for a guy like myself to make decisions, yes, I want to know as much as I possibly can, but the facts are, I only really need to know the high-level highlights so that I can point and say, this is the direction that we need to go as a team, this is where we're going to head as a company.
Our consumers of information, our engine assemblers, our shop people, they need to know very specific things, and they need to know them fast. We don't want them to be software people, and so Team Center allows us to organize our business objects pertinent to the information they need to get.
As engineers, what we want is we want to have all of the product data in one place that we can leverage it and optimize it and share it amongst the technical group here at Motorsports.
As a company, we're able to, with the people that we have and the resources that we've got, they're able to come to us with answers, not just data. Because it wasn't so long ago, they came to us with all the data, and it was all here, and then I had to go through and sift to figure out what it was.
And so I use Team Center NX daily to design new parts, work on new solutions. But then also as a manager, I'm using those tools to look at problems. When we have an issue at the racetrack, we have generate a problem report. Analyze that problem report. What solution do we need to implement to not allow this to happen again?
You know, now it's evolved to where every component is drawn. Almost every component has gone through FEA.
We went from being prototype to additive manufacturing. So now it truly is a manufacturing technology. We can take the NX tools and draw parts and make parts that you can't make any other way.
I think it's really neat that I can sit down next to an engineer. Myself, again, I'm not an engineer, so I need a visualization of what's actually going on. And they can pop up the product, whatever that component is, and they can just show me from a 3D view exactly what it is that they're building and where they're thinking. And I can help give a little direction and guidance from my standpoint and, you know, push play and get the parts in our hands.
Yeah, the key benefit that the Siemens software products give us here at Hendrick Motorsports is the speed of response to make a competitive change, to fix problems, and to create more performance at the racetrack in a very tight window of time.
We have to continue to evolve. We have to continue to ask ourselves the tough questions, the hard questions. I work for the best team in motorsports with very driven individuals and a culture at Hendrick Motorsports that we have a responsibility to honor and keep up. We're just gonna try to outwork everybody with the amazing resources we have at our fingertips.
So think about that, one of the most successful race teams in history, and I promise you if they don't digitalize and they don't do what they're doing, they don't win. It's just really that simple for them, and not winning, there's no points for second place in their business. So think about the pressure that team faces, you know, 1 week innovation cycles, the equivalent of 36 product launches a year, continuously optimizing product production and product performance so they can win races. So that's the other extreme of competitive pressure and what innovation does in their business. And then, you know, just finally, as I close and move on, you know, winning, and for most of us in the room, winning depends on beating the competition with some of the key KPIs you see here. Speed, time to market, we believe, is one of the greatest advantages companies have today. So the ones that get to market fast have a first mover advantage, capitalize on a profitable component of their business. I mean, look at one of the world's most successful product launches in history right now, where they can't push products out the door fast enough, which is Tesla, right? I mean, they have a record historic backlog. Time to market for them is everything. Everyone's catching up. And if you think about this, product complexity has really doubled in the last 15 years. Product life cycles have been shortened by about 25%. We talked about flexibility and mass customization. I mean, consumer companies, apparel companies, how Adidas is producing shoes. It took them 18 months, and now it's taking them 3 or 4 days because they're digitalizing the entire production. And I don't order shoes this way, but I guess the tweens or whoever's ordering shoes, they want them customized, and their numbers on them, and their names on them, they want them within a week. And so, you know, that cycle has to be accelerated, has to be innovated. Quality, you know, the DPM. I mean, people want good quality, and digitalization drives good quality. So that transformation is really helping companies monetize new business models, discover how they improve, and I think you're going to hear it now from Tenaris, who's really taking advantage of some of these technologies to stay ahead of the competition. So let me just open up with a few comments on Tenaris and introduce our panelist here. So Tenaris, just for the background of those that don't know it, it's a leading global supplier of steel piping and related services for the oil and gas exploration and production operations. So with plants in North America, South America, Europe, and Asia, Tenaris produces more than 6 million tons of steel pipes each year. And to stay competitive and profitable, Tenaris is always looking for ways to drive greater production efficiency, enhancing plant safety. And in Bay City, Texas, Tenaris recently built a brand new plant, which is the world's most automated, seamless pipe-making plant. And that greenfield facility represents an investment of about $1.8 billion, over 1.5 million square feet, and employs 600 people. And I can tell you, if you ever walk that plant, you never know they have 600 people walking around that plant, because it's that sophisticated and that automated. And they opened in 2017, so I'm really proud and honored that we were able to get Nain off his, he's a very busy guy, and we really appreciate what he does, and I'm happy he was able to take some time out today to tell us a little bit more about how they achieve efficiency, quality, and most importantly, safety. So please join me in welcoming Tenaris' Director of Automation for the U.S., Nain Rivera.
Can I borrow that from you? Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me here. Okay, as Raj already anticipated, Tenaris is a leading company that provides basically tubular solutions for the energy sector. We cover other areas, but mainly oil and gas and energy production. Well, we already said a little bit about Tenaris. We are establishing, we have 30 plus facilities, industrial facilities of production around the world. We cover more than 25 countries. And we have five main areas where we develop products, where we develop technology, always for the oil and gas. Those R&D centers are one of the most important things that Tenaris has to provide differentiation and to give our customers what we need to do. As we said, we cover the market around the world, and OCTG is one of our main, areas and focuses. We have the production of welded pipes for offshore and onshore pipelines, but our main, production is focused on very complex products for made of seamless steel pipes for the casing and tubing and in the OCTG. We're gonna see now a video that was, I believe, done 1 year ago when we were starting this new facility in the United States, which actually is the first seamless manufacturing facility for pipes done by Tenaris as a greenfield project. So we're gonna see a little bit of the video now. Well, with 60 years plus of industrial culture, Tenaris had a vision to innovate, a vision to give to our customers better solutions. To do that, we engaged to a very interesting challenge, which was to put in reality all our ideas, or our experience, again, all our vision to differentiate and to give our customers the best. To do that, we started this project in 2013 defining what we need, what we want to innovate, what we want to give to our customers. So we defined what we wanted to have in this plant. Again, we have other 30 plus plants and we know what to do, right? But we wanted to do it differently. We want to, again, to be different. So safety integrated is one of the first focus of Tenaris, being able to provide this for our people on the floor and as a result to our customers with the product we deliver to them. Mobility. To be able of the to give more tools to the operations guys, you know, they need that. So in the past we used to have these fixed pulpits all around the plant. So now we wanted to give them the possibility to go wireless, to go mobile, and with all the safety requirements to develop their tasks safely. Advanced maintenance features. I think this is one of the key points. We wanted to have a plant that can be connected, getting know-how from all the other Tenaris facilities, because at the end, technology is not enough. You need to combine technology with experience. You need to combine technology with know-how. So remote monitoring, redundancy, diagnostics, video-based analysis to provide all this together. At the end, the target is to have a conditioning-based maintenance. Full traceability, this is key in our system. This is key in the differentiation point of view for Tenaris. So we have a lot of applications and we have a lot of tools that we actually give to our customers. One of those is the pipe tracer, where all our customers can track our pipes on the yard, on their facility, on the shore, wherever they are doing an installation, they can have all the data they need to correlate it with quality, to correlate it to everything they need on site. Of course, supported by us. But this, again, was the vision 4 years before we start the plan. This is what we wanted to do. Use all the possibilities as RFID and so on to have the tracking of all our tools and all our products. Another very important key point of differentiation was to have an automated working in process area, a WIP, where actually we handle our pipes that we are still in production phase automatically. Everything is automated, so there's no people moving pipes, which, as you can understand, our core business is a heavy industry. I mean, we have to take care of the people. So as Raj was saying, even though we have a lot of people working on the facility, you don't see them on the shop floor. I mean, because most of the lines are fully automated. Ergonomics, to give the operators the possibility to be in the best shape. Because basically, if you are comfortable, you can do better. So this was our focus also. And virtual commissioning, which I believe was the key of this project. Rush also talked a little bit about that in his presentation. I mean, the possibility to, in advance, being able to test, being able to be sure that all your design combined with the safety, combined with the mobility, tracking, everything, it works, it gives you an advantage that there's no way to compete with that. Of course, give you optimization of your real commissioning on the floor, because a plant like this, I don't know, takes 6 months to 1 year to put in service, and we did it in 4 months. So this is the impact of the virtual commissioning on this. Also training for our operators safety, because at the end, being able to test, to actually emulate, not simulate, emulate the plant, connecting to the manufacturing system, it means PLCs and computers and so on, give you the possibility to be sure that all the protections, all the safety-related devices and systems are working perfectly before going to the real machine and try it there. So that give you also an advantage, very, very important advantage. Last but not least, the conclusion of all this was digitalization. The fact that we got digital, the fact that difference from maybe other facilities of Tenaris before this one, that some of the activities, even though if for the last 18 years we've been working on automation, some of those do not have everything that we're talking or that we had as a challenge in this facility. To be able to have all the data possible to later on build over that data. That means shop floor integration, to have from the sensors, from all the measurements we can do, up to the top level of information. This also requires, of course, the vision to be sure that as we were listening yesterday in one of the presentations, the fact that you have to be prepared to what will happen, which is that you have an issue on this new world of everything is interconnected. So the cybersecurity, to be sure that your networks are prepared to do this is key component of success in digitalization. Big data mining and artificial intelligence. I think this is the key of going one step forward, at least on the manufacturing process of pipes, which before this mill, there is no hot rolling mill that has these features. That in other areas are already applied, but not in our industry. And this gives you, again, a very good position in the market and with our customers. To be able not to depend on one person idea, one person calculating something, or maybe a paper there or here or there, but to have, with all this data reading, to be able to correlate quality issues, to improve them, and more than that, to prevent them. To be sure that the pipes we put on to our clients are all of them in compliance with the requirements. Predictive analytics, basically. So after the challenge, we just have to define how to implement this, and we again. Combination of vision, mindset of where we want to go, and technology. And we choose Siemens. Siemens could provide all the technology that we needed to go ahead and implement this project. From PLCs, drives, software, which is key component, Antia Portal at that time was also something new in the market, and we decided to embrace this challenge together and work together to have this as one of the features of our plant, mobility that we already mentioned it before. Still great capacity to be able to have equipment on the floor in a very, very difficult, industry, which is the pipe production. Safety, of course, safety integrated. Energy saving, advanced features of safety to be sure that the people can do their task easily. If safety is complicated, people will try to bypass it. So safety has to be integrated on their daily activities. And networking, the integration from the floor to the top level, including wireless, redundancy, protocols, and so on. And finally, simulation, virtualization. And with the CIMIT and the simulation unit and PALM software that we use from Siemens, we could accomplish this in a really impressive way. We have operators trained 6 months, 1 year in advance. We have the mill there for them, okay? So it was not a training watching videos, if not if not moving the machine, which was virtualized. And as Rush also mentioned, this project was the biggest project in regards of integration of TIA Portal and Profinet systems all together, all the different software and platforms. We have over 4,000 nodes. This is a little bit of the numbers of the project, above 100 PLCs, I/O input outputs more than 50,000. So a huge project. I believe that collaboration is the key to be able to go digital. You cannot do this alone. I mean, you might, but I believe it's better to have this collaboration spirit. Mixing technology with know-how, and this is what we did. And Siemens helped us a lot to do this in different ways, not just in the products, not just in the software, but also in the support and the management, because this project was a worldwide project with a lot of different vendors around the world, and we could do this thanks to them. So thank you very much. This was the brief of the Bay City project.
Man, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Let's maybe have a seat here, and I'm gonna grill you on a couple questions. So. I'm just kidding.
Not too much.
Yeah, not too. So I have to say thanks to really. You have to see that plan to really appreciate it, and you know. And I have to say, when I was there, it's amazing that you're in a heavy industry, yet there's so many control rooms. You don't see a lot of people on the factory floor, yeah. And it's a just-in-time, seamless steel pipe plant, which is absolutely amazing to me. That you know that if you're running a fracking operation and you need pipes, you know it's a just-in-time type of ordering. So we talk about mass customization. We talk about the ability to serve customers quickly, and I think this—you know—you would never think in a heavy industry that this would be possible, but I think you guys did it, and with a lot of work, a lot of effort. So let me just ask you a couple questions on the timing behind the Bay City project. You know, you were committed to this project during a time when the oil and gas market was down. So yep. It probably was conceived. The multi-billion-dollar investment was conceived when oil prices were maybe hovering around $100 a barrel.
Yeah, I didn't
right?
know about
so,
that.
So, I mean, everyone in the oil and gas industry is making money. And then all of a sudden, you started the project, and I think it may have dropped to the low of something like, you know.
30s,
right?
And in the moment, below 30. So
So tell me about that a bit. Tell me about the culture, the environment, you know, how you persevered through that.
Well, again, the vision, no? Our CEO is focused on customer service, and we decided that we have to offer this to our clients in the U.S. and in the world, and we wanted to go ahead with investment, even though it was a very difficult decision, but I think it was the right one. And this is thanks of the health of the company, or the financial strongest of the company at that point, which also is very different from our competitors. So we had the opportunity to take a decision to continue with this challenge. And I think it was a very good decision, because now when the market is again ramping up, we are ready. We are ready with pipes there, with pipes and with a process that nobody else has. So.
Yeah.
It was a very, very good decision.
It really gives you a big competitive advantage.
Yes.
So tell me about the path to digitalization. You know, I think you're a great case study of a company that has, what, 30 or how many plants around the world?
We have over 30.
Okay, you have over 30 plants. Yeah. This is the most sophisticated one.
Yes.
And sometimes the thinking is to just clone what you have done elsewhere. Right, which maybe isn't as automated.
That will be the easiest way. Yeah.
Right, that'd be the easiest way. That's a path of least resistance. So tell me about just the journey of this one to really digitalize, to make it state of the art. What, you know, I mean, how did this start, and how did you go about it?
Again, I believe it's a vision, no? Because as you said, the easiest way was just to. I mean, we have other plants that we also produce seamless steel pipes, so we could just bring the same solutions and make them run in, I don't know, 1 year, 2 years, and that's it. But we decided to go beyond that. So with a mindset that you want to differentiate from the others, that you want to get opportunity, again, technology is there, but not apply to our industry. We said, why not? Going there, being different, being able to give our customers data that at the end we understood they needed, but nobody was able to give it to them. So we decide to do this plan in this way so that we can have a product at the end based on this, on the way we produce this product, that is different from the others, that they can understand even what was, I don't know, the speed of the heat that provides that steel for that specific pipe.
Right.
So all this correlation information that is needed on the OCTG industry and applications, this was, I believe, one of the key factors that we decided to go in this way.
Yeah, and then I think one of your slides referenced virtual commissioning. And I think that was a big, big component of time and labor savings and implementation in the plant. And can you talk about some of the benefits of virtual commissioning? So doing this in a simulated way before you have any physical assets and automation assets out on the factory floor. Maybe, talk to that a bit, what it saved you and how it accelerated the process.
Yeah, basically the commissioning of the real, the optimization of the real commissioning time. This is the most important point or the most evident result, right? So to reduce the time that typically takes to put in service such a facility. That means cost reduction, that means, again, optimization. But it's not the only point. To be honest, when we start this, we start thinking about reducing this time. That was the main target. While we were starting to develop this solution, we understood that we could get a lot of more than that. And we did. And the first point is safety. So we were able to test a lot of things that typically you do or you can do until you are there. Until you are there with the pipe, with the hot steel, because it's not able to, we were not able in the past to emulate this.
Yeah.
And we did. So safety, I think, it was one of the most important components besides the cost reduction or in addition to it. And also training. To be able to the operator and the new people in the U.S. that we hire for this project to understand the how to operate these type of facilities, besides that we take them to the other Tenaris facility to learn and so on, to be on this emulating environment and test everything they will later do was one of the keys also.
Yeah, and when I think of putting a greenfield in the middle of Bay City. I mean, this, of course, is not the hotbed of digitalization, right? So you had to...
south of Texas.
Yeah, south of Texas, right? I mean, so in essence, you had to, you put up a greenfield, you had to train people.
Yep.
You had to bring a whole new crew of people of that 600 on board to operate the plant. So tell me about the journey of training people and doing this without a physical plant.
Yeah, again, what we did is we have the emulation of the complete plant, and we focus on all the working instructions that the operator had to do, and we put them all the, situations where they have to do things. And this virtual commission includes physics, includes gravity. So, if they commit a mistake, let's say, a pipe can jump out of the line, for instance, no? Or
yeah.
Break.
Yeah.
So we did this to try to help them to be ready for what was coming, and it was very, very useful. I think this is one of the takeaways for the complete organization. We are now promoting to one of the steps of the digitalization for the rest of the plants is to go on the way of virtual commissioning. This is.
Yes.
Key component.
Okay, great. So I'm just looking at the time, and I want to maybe ask one or two more questions. Tell me about the cultural aspect of the plant. You know, I think a lot of people that start the journey to do digital, it's not just all about technology, right? I mean, technology is one facet of it, and there's lots of technology out there, but there's also a mindset change of people. And, how did you overcome some of the cultural barriers of this, right? So, I think in the U.S., we have a classic situation where you have a frozen middle that doesn't, it's resistant to change
yeah.
in manufacturing. And in your case, you're taking it to the red line and really changing at a very, very rapid pace. So how did you handle the culture change there?
I believe you have to define a clear goal that is common to everyone. When you define that, then to create the path together as a team is easier, even though if that means that a lot of people, but why we're doing this? If in the past, I mean, the relay solution works, why are we doing this?
Right.
But when you put the target or one of your goals is not just to make the machine to move, but to, for instance, do predictive analysis, to be able to understand before it happens that if we continue like this, our pipes are not gonna be good and we have to rework. So avoiding going to that. If you put that goal and you tell the guys, okay, now we do it with relays, can we do it? Maybe not.
Right.
So you start doing this change, this mindset that has to adjust it to what is happening today. Again, technology is there, but the application, the applicability of this to our industry, this is the challenge, I believe.
Yeah. So maybe the last question. Tell me, what are your, you know, what would you counsel the audience on in your top two or three takeaways about going digital, and best practice recommendations to start their journey to digitalize manufacturing?
If I have to just pick three, I would say first, define the goals. I mean, which is the focus of your manufacturing process? What do you want to do as a company? Where do you want to go? And based and I believe this is the first step. I mean, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to be different from the competitors because of this. I want to have data, but which data? To do what? You have to define this. So definition, I mean, goals, targets is, in my opinion, the first best practice that you have to do to go digital. Second for me is collaboration. As I said, technology is there, but we have to combine these to be success. So I think MAPA is a very good platform to do this because you will understand that you need from others. And collaborating, you will get results. So second point for me will be collaboration. And third, again, I will say technology. You have to focus with the fact that technology is moving. It's moving, and you have to understand how you can apply this technology to get your objectives through collaboration. So these three things together, I will say, is the path.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much. That's very insightful. And of course, this is now the new norm in Tenaris, right, as we go forward.
Yes.
The new norm starts with this plant.
Yes.
So expansions from here on don't go back to the old, they go to the new.
No, of course, yeah. Of course. Good. I mean, when you see the results, when you see that you have, that the information you can get is automatically applied to a better product, to a safer environment, you don't want to go back. I mean,
right.
The results are there. Again, risks are always there also, no? But you have to manage the risk. You have to control it. You have to countermeasure the risk. And then you got the results.
Yeah, great. Well, I have to say you passed this quiz with flying colors. So thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your insight. It looks like, Stephen, we have about 7 or 8 minutes left here. So I'm going to go to the screen and start some of those questions. And.
Okay.
And I'll take some and you take some. You know? So we both will have to pass this again. So
okay,
so let me go to the first one. The reality is very few greenfield plants are built. We need solutions that are retrofittable and can be phased as we roll through a factory cell by cell. So maybe let me add my perspective to that.
Please.
And you can add to it. So that's absolutely true. I think, you know, I mean, that is U.S. manufacturing. We're a brownfield modernization environment here in the United States, largely. And you know, the comments that I prefaced my presentation with are, is digitalization scalable. You know, it's not an SAP rollout, if you think about that, where you know you have 5 years of investment, and nothing against SAP, they're a great company, but you know, you have 5 years of investment, you have a lot of resources being applied, and then 5 years later you see the ROI because there has to be a big culture change. I think that people demand quick ROI on digitalization projects. So again, technology is out there that's very scalable. So it's not an all or nothing play. It's a scalable play. You know, you have some companies that start with digitally transformative elements of their manufacturing process. Some work on the design and ideation side. Some work on the digitalization of advanced automation, you know, which is what you did as Tenaris, you virtually commissioned. You digitalized the entire automation system. You simulated the plant. Yep. So I think the key takeaway, it's a very scalable technology and it's very applicable to brownfields. But the journey starts with a vision. The journey starts with an end state and an end goal, and then you have to work your way in.
Let me just add saying that, for instance, virtual commission, maybe in existing plants, you don't need this, right? Maybe you don't, maybe you do. But that's not the only differentiation or advantage you will get with digitalization. Obsolescence is a reality. So you have to start planning that when obsolescence is coming to your manufacturing process, to your cell, to your specific unit, you have to understand what you want to do and because you have to change anyway because you have an obsolescence issue. So this is also a very good opportunity to be able to roll out and to implement maybe not all the aspects, but at least to start building the base that you will use later, escalate it, and get very, very important benefits from it.
Yeah, that's great. Maybe let me add one more point on the change relative to talent and people. So, you know, we have a couple million workers that are eligible for retirement in the next decade, and I can promise that the new crew coming in doesn't think like the old crew. And so the new crew coming in is tech savvy, they're digital natives, they're gonna challenge the status quo, and they wanna work more or less for digitally enabled companies. And so I think there's a recruitment, retention, attraction aspect to it as well when you're moving to this higher state of technology. Okay, let me go to the next question there. I see some value in the digital twin on major new product launches, but let's face it, most products are incremental. How does a digital twin play here? Well, I think the digital twin is not just about a product launch. A digital twin can be simulation of the production environment. It could be simulation of a robot cell. It could be looking at the ergonomics and travel of anything inside that plant. So again, it goes back to the scalability topic of technology available to incrementally improve manufacturing processes. Digitalization of just the automation system, that can happen in a brownfield. So again, digital twin is not always the full end-to-end play. It can be, and that's a great state to be in, but there are also transformative steps to the digital twin. And more or less, when we think of automation, we think of manufacturing execution systems, we think of the product design environments. These are the three ecosystems that normally exist in manufacturing operations, and all those can be virtualized and simulated without doing physical work, where the decision quality is enhanced and you get better results out of it, okay? So maybe let me go to the next one. I think this is yours, Nain, for sure. How is Tenaris taking this to their other facilities?
Well, basically, as we said, not in the same scale, but in the aspects that are applied to other facilities, we are doing it. Focus on safety, focus on the use or better use of data for quality purpose of our product, then to help better our customers. We are focused on that, and again, we are analyzing each line, each process where we can add things, because as some of the questions were mentioning, we are in the same situation. I mean, we have already 60 years of lines of implementations done, and we produce pipes, but we can do it better. So we're analyzing where we can implement this to have results. And this is a work that started again like 18 years ago, and step by step we're getting there. And now we are with the vision of the predictive analytics, which in my opinion is a differentiation.
Yeah, and I think this next one's gonna go to you as well. How afraid are you of obsolescence in controls choice, and have you pre-planned upgrading?
Again, for Bay City, I will say we expect that we are far from that stage in Bay City. In the rest of our plants,
I can also give you a lot of confidence on that one too.
So okay, good share. Thank you. Later we talk about wireless mobile
panels.
Yeah,
that sounds good.
So in Bay City, I believe we don't have this issue, and we expect not to have it. In the other plants, we do face this. I mean, it's not that we're afraid, it's a reality. We have a master plan in the CapEx engineering investments where it's focused also to obsolescence, and it's a reality. And we planify that, trying to affect the lessor lines, because we are committed with our clients. We have to deliver pipes. So, but of course, we have to ensure reliability on our operations with the quality and safety that we require. So, we have to make a plan. We already have it, and investment. This is what you have to do.
Yeah. Okay. This is actually a good one. How much ongoing Siemens support is needed for this facility?
You want to take this one?
No, I'm going to give it to you.
How much ongoing Siemens support? If you define what you need to do in advance and you planify this, the implementation is smooth. And we worked together before the plant was up. We worked together from the design of the mill. We worked together also developing better the product, because they had a product and we have a need. And combining them, we have to do changes. And they were open to do it, and they did it for us. Core changes on software, for instance, on firmwares, on drives, and so on. So this collaboration actually allow you, now that we are up and running, not to need, 24-hour support. We don't, because the system is already designed in a way that doesn't need this baby sitting care all the time. But the truth is that to arrive to there, you have to establish a very, very specific schedule, a plan, and work together. And again, the facility is there.
Great. Yeah, and I think that's a great proof point. So thank you very much.